In the Bible, St. Paul said, "When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things." But St. Paul didn't have an Xbox and never had a chance to play Halo with Jesus and the apostles. Had the Last Supper been the last LAN party? Who knows how that story ends. In short, Halo rocks so hard, it might have saved Jesus' life.
It's Britney, bitch.
George Bush doesn't care about black people.
Our education, like such as South Africa and the Iraq, everywhere like such as, and...
We sitting here, I'm supposed to be the franchise player, and we're in here talking about practice.
Ladies and gentlemen, we got him.
Out, Charlie!
Our next-door neighbors are foreign countries.
I call upon all nations to do everything they can to stop these terrorist killers.
Thank you.
Now watch this drive.
All right. Hello, everyone. Welcome to Remember Shuffle. And today we will be talking about Halo.
We're talking about Beyoncé Knowles' 2014 hit Halo.
Oh, yeah, we're going to have Scooter put that in. Halo is one of the most successful game franchises of all time, with all the games across the franchise selling over 81 million copies by February of 2021. It's made over $6 billion. But interestingly, Microsoft doesn't break that number down by individual games in the series, especially if they're unsuccessful. So we know that Halo 3 sold something like 5 million copies, but they haven't released the numbers for Halo 4 or Halo 5 : Guardians or Halo : Infinite. Given what we know about the sales of these earlier Halos, it seems like it's certainly a franchise that's been on the decline. But what people might forget is that this game was everywhere in the 2000s. The franchise bookends the decade nicely. The first Halo game came out in 2001, and the last game that was made by the original design team, Bungie, came out in 2010, so perfectly mirroring the entire decade. And you could see it across pop culture. Characters in Scrubs and The Big Bang Theory and The 40-Year-Old Virgin played it, and there was even a very weird, cringy sketch on Mad TV.
Jen, run! It's some kind of space robot!
No, this is my boyfriend.
What?
Mom, Dad, this is...
Master Chief!
For a long time, this was the reason people bought an Xbox. It was one of the Xbox exclusives that people really dug playing. And it was kind of the epitome of a very specific kind of bro gaming culture, with Halo even partnering up with Mountain Dew. I don't know if this is where we got the beginning of the gamer Mountain Dew connection, but it certainly, we have one piece of evidence here. And I think maybe its most significant contribution to culture, generally, not just popular culture, but perhaps even Western civilization, was the phenomenon of teabagging, where after you killed an opponent in the game, you use the crouch feature to make your player avatar look as if you were putting your testicles on the opponent's faceplate mask. It's very, very funny. It's a cross-cultural, really, you know, I shouldn't have even said Western civilization. I should have said the common human heritage that Halo contributed to. So that's what we're talking about today. And with me, as always, is my co-host, Giordano.
Hello, hello.
And we have our expert guest in the form of Jordan Drew.
Hey, folks. Oh, full name.
Yeah. Sorry, should I not say it?
No, just give him my full address.
We'll call him Master Keith.
Love it.
So yeah, let's just cover like why Halo's important. Like, why does anybody give a shit? Let's say you're Amish or just very low T and you don't know what Halo is.
Sure.
It was Microsoft's flagship game, right? So Halo 2 and Halo 1 are the number 2 and 1 best-selling Xbox games of all time. And it's not even close. The third best-selling Xbox game, by the way, Sneak King, the Burger King game that was made and given out for free.
I think you just played as like the creepy Burger King mascot and tried to scare people. It's just stalking the video game.
Oh, like the mask, the grotesque mask Burger King era.
Yes, the very same.
The third episode of our podcast is actually a Sneak King episode. So we'll have to put the table this discussion for now. But we take for granted that there's like a popular American gaming console, because the success of the Xbox was never guaranteed. It was a weird thing that came out in the sixth generation. And this was the only exclusive that I think was worth playing. Like, you had other options like Mech Assault or Amped Snowboarding, but no one was getting an Xbox to play Blinks the Time Sweeper or something.
And Halo, I think it was so great because it had a very low bar for entry. It's a sci-fi game. It's a sci-fi shooter, which played really well. It had really balanced combat. And despite the fact that it had all of this lore in the tie-in products, which I think we'll get into later, very light on story. The lore is 90% setting and 10% story. It's a game about going pew-pew to the aliens and to your friends over split screen.
Yeah, I really wanted to get to that. Talk about the kind of scope that the Halo story takes, again, at the beginning of the decade versus the end. Because Halo 1, right, when it comes out, Combat Evolved, it's super light on story. It's like it's an atmosphere kind of game. You know, you're lost spacemen that have found some ancient alien shit, and you're going pew-pew in the process of discovering what's going on with this ancient alien shit, right?
Let's talk about, first of all, what makes it a sick-ass game. First thing that I think jumps out is the controls. If GoldenEye was the party shooter of the 90s, Halo is the party shooter of the 2000s because of the dual stick. Which is universal today. Every shooter has it.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, you also had the fact that it had a co-op campaign. This was like the first co-op campaign I ever remember playing. And what I loved about it is that they made absolutely no attempt to integrate the co-op into the cutscenes. You were one guy in the cutscenes, and you just morphed into two guys. Fuck it, who cares?
the only point in the game that ever happens is the very beginning, because there are two cryogenic coffins that you and your friend pop out of at the beginning of the game. Yeah. And then after that, every cutscene has one Master Chief. All the story is told as if there's one Master Chief. It's like, who cares? The plot is this. Have fun with your friend.
Yeah.
And then when Halo 2 came out, according to Eurogamer, it was by far the most popular online game, like widely ahead of Call of Duty 2, which was the number two game. Mm-hmm. The combat was just very balanced. You had all these different weapons that seemed special, and vehicles and grenades and melee, and like, you used everything.
Because 2 introduced dual wielding for the first time. Mm-hmm. And that threw off the entire balance of the game.
And that changed everything, because the whole thing with Halo originally was that, in theory, every weapon fit into a niche, and it was the only weapon that fit into that niche, right? And then once you added the dual wielding and more redundancy in Halo 2, like, now there was two sniper rifles. There's the human sniper rifle and the alien sniper rifle.
Yeah.
And so it was almost a step back towards your sort of GoldenEye idea of, oh, your guy carries like 18 guns at a time, right?
Yeah.
You can still only carry two, but it's like, oh, there's a bunch of machine guns and a bunch of pistols and this and that.
Yeah. Also, on the topic of guns, for me, and this is why I love having you on the podcast, Jordan, if I'm playing like Call of Duty or Battlefield or whatever, I don't want to learn the names of any guns. I don't want to know what a fucking BAR is. I want a gun that's called the Needler or the Plasma.
Yeah.
Something that tells you exactly what it is. Yes.
that is what Halo 1 gives you, right? Is literally you pick up the pistol, the assault rifle, the plasma rifle.
And of course, the vehicles, right? I think that's part of what the evolved in the Combat Evolved was. This was the first game that I remember in multiplayer being able to run over your friends, which was sweet.
Yeah, with like fully realized physics, where the, you know, four wheels on the Warthog could leave the ground and the whole thing bounced around. In 2001, I had never played a game where there was vehicles, but they were integrated in such a way that you could just hop in, hop out in the midst of a level, like just at will. Like, there was games that had a vehicle level before that, right?
Yeah, and the Warthog is iconic of Halo, because it's meant to be driven by like multiple people. Like, it's only effective when it's in multiplayer.
Yeah, I mean, look at Elon Musk's stupid Cybertruck. He's trying to make a Warthog. Clearly, famous gamer Elon Musk.
Yeah, so supposedly the Warthog actually was part of what made Halo first-person shooter, because it was originally supposed to be some sort of
RTS,
like top-down strategy game, like an RTS. Yeah. And I guess the dev team, they were designing this Warthog, and what I imagine is they probably had their physics engine partially made and got to watch this thing bounce and slide around, right? And I forget the guy's name, but according to this dude in an interview, they all wanted to drive the Warthog. Nice. They want to click the Warthog around like an RTS. Yes, they want to drive the Warthog, and that turned into them building this game into something where you are now a guy that hopped into the Warthog and drove the Warthog, and that's what catalyzed it turning into a first-person shooter.
That's awesome.
So it's almost the vehicles did almost come before the gunplay in terms of making the game a shooter.
Yeah, what I especially loved about the vehicle combat is, like, you could get in the Warthog and have your buddy get in the little turret, and you're playing together, you're sitting on the couch, you feel like tactical operators driving around the map.
Yeah.
But also, it still didn't ruin the balance, because someone with a sniper rifle could shoot the driver, and then that would be that, or like hit you with a rocket launcher, or stick a sticky grenade on you. Like, even with these vehicles, the one exception being the stupid tank, Scorpion, as it was called. With the exception of the tank, even the vehicle play was balanced and integrated in a meaningful way.
It was just the super lightning in a bottle game. Sorry, are we on separate tracks?
Leaving this screw up in the episode, because it's actually kind of funny. Our guest knew more about recording than we did. This was our second episode that we ever recorded, and JD asked if we were recording on separate tracks. We didn't even realize you could do that, and when he pointed it out to us, we promptly did nothing.
Sorry, lightning in a bottle. Finish that thought.
Yeah, it's just a super lightning in a bottle game, because not only does it have this vehicle integration that I hadn't seen before that was new to us, it also was put into the game with some love and care to make it balanced.
I think maybe the longest lasting impression, Cortana, right? Microsoft named its version of Siri Alexa after this fictional AI in Halo.
Yeah, that was pretty wild.
Especially since I know, you know, in the later games, Cortana becomes the big bad. She becomes like the AI goes rogue and takes over the robots and you need to kill them. Again, the classic sci-fi trope.
Yeah, it's also one of the most sexualized, like, weird minor characters and operating system assistants.
Sorry.
Let's get into that, because I've been saying this for years. So, first Halo game. Scooter, get that picture up. Cortana is barely opaque. There's the suggestion that maybe she's some sort of sexy lady, but she's barely opaque. You can barely make out her features, let alone her curves, if any. There's the suggestion that she might be, you know, an attractive hologram lady, but she's not there to be that. She is a wisecracking supercomputer, right, that has the form of a lady, because a cool science lady is a cool thing.
Yep.
By Halo 2, Cortana's appearance has changed drastically, where her entire body is now opaque, so you can see every line of her hips.
So they reverse Layla Bunny'd her.
Oh, absolutely. And like, you know, like
Lola Bunny.
And she gets a more juvenile face and curvier and more opaque in every subsequent Halo game.
Nice, dude.
Yeah, and it's funny because she has the anatomy of a Barbie doll, right? It's like there's no nipples and she's not wearing clothes because she doesn't have anything to cover. It's the hologram waifu, man.
I'm a bigger fan of Clippy cosplay, but after Clippy, it's definitely the hottest virtual assistant. I was telling Ben that the Cortana subreddit is really funny because, like, uh-oh, most of the posts are from people who are actually using Cortana as an assistant. It'll be like, oh, I'm a blind person and Cortana is so helpful. And then some of the posts are like, look at this hand-drawn picture of Cortana's feet.
She does have bare feet, IRC. I'm sure as the games go on, her toes become more defined. Yeah, they almost had a female protagonist, basically protagonist in a video game that was not sexualized at all. The only reason she was sexy in Halo 1 is because she was like funny and shit, right? She was like a funny, smart lady.
And because she's competent. What is sexier than competency?
Yeah, so she's this competent, so nerdy girl. And yeah, so that's going to maybe get your 13-year-old brain moving in one direction in the game.
Yeah. Closing thoughts on Cortana. This is something I was telling Jordana before we hit record. Apparently all the virtual assistants default to women's voices because people, Anglophones in North America, are more likely to receive facts and information from a woman's voice and more likely to respect commands from a man's voice. So let's not unpack that right now.
Yeah, you were telling me on the New York City subway system that commands come from a guy, like, please stand clear of the closing doors.
Yeah.
And information comes from a woman.
Yeah, they have both. Yeah. That's did that with a grain of salt, though. I lifted it from a John Mulaney bit, but the bit about the New York City subway is true.
Okay, and, John Mulaney coming soon to Halo 7. as the voice of the reconfigurer.
Capture the flag.
Oh, do you remember? Sorry, I got to put a dollar in the jar because I opened the sentence with, do you remember? Do you remember the voice in the multiplayer who would say things like,
gained the lead. Lost the lead.
Now imagine that in a John Mulaney voice.
Gain the lead. You lost the lead.
Yeah. And I think final thoughts on why Halo rocks. The soundtrack. Iconic orchestral chorus that tells you you're playing in a Halo game.
Scooter, throw up the orchestral soundtrack.
Yeah, and like in the single player, they did a really good job of sound design and where the music was used. Like there was some real love and care put into when those musical cues came in throughout the story. Like Ben said, it's like 90% atmosphere in that game, right? As far as actually the story.
The Halo 2 soundtrack, by the way, featured such artists as Incubus, Hoobastank, and Breaking Benjamin.
Yeah. Don't forget Steve Vai shredding guitar over the main theme.
Yeah, that's awesome.
And you know what? That is all the that, like, I'm glad you brought that up, because that's all emblematic of how the series expands and evolves over the decade. In my opinion, in a lot of ways worse, even though Halo 2 was awesome.
Yeah.
Where it goes from this small story of the lost ship on the ancient aliens place, right? And then it turns into this galaxy-spanning space opera with talking aliens and
hive minds and Promethean artifacts. Yeah.
Yeah.
Actually, this is a great segue, because I did want to talk about how Halo declined, because you have the original four games by Bungie, and then you have another trilogy that's come out over the course of the 2010s that's made by a developing team that's called 343 Gaming, which is funny because the 343 Gaming was a team founded by Microsoft just to keep shitting out Halo games.
Yeah.
Named after a character from the Halo 1 campaign. Full disclosure, I haven't played any of these, but you can see a lot of the trends that make Halo shitty over these years are just general trends in gaming that have been bad. So in the most recent ones, there are microtransactions as expensive as $3.95. That is a macro transaction. That is no longer micro. You have no more split screen. Halo 5 dropped the split screen co-op entirely, so you can't play on the couch with your friends, but they do have split screen over Xbox Live so that all of your friends can like buy their own TVs and Xboxes and you can play separate. And yeah, I think just this trend of you have an IP that you established 20 years ago that people kind of make, and now you can, you know, crap these out every year or so. And you also have the fact that Halo used to have its niche as the pew-pew sci-fi shooter. And now you've had Battlefield and Call of Duty start to go to the far future and get their grappling hooks and lasers and plasma whatevers. Mm-hmm. And you've also had Halo get more like them. Again, I haven't played them, yes, but having done my research, apparently new Halo has the revive mechanics, it has kill cams, it has the sprinting and dashing. They've even incorporated a bunch of quick time events in the campaigns. Like, it's just this singularity of shooters.
Yeah, some of that really started pretty shortly after Halo got off the ground, right? Like, as of Halo Combat Evolved coming out, right? Like, the only Call of Duty games that existed were, I think, Call of Duty 2, when it was still like this World War II game, mm-hmm, that, like, honestly, most people, I think Medal of Honor was probably even more popular at the time, right?
Yeah.
I've never been able
to separate those two franchises in my mind.
Those series are indistinguishable to me now, right? And that's, mm-hmm, for the exact reason you're talking about, which is that, like, games have reached this singularity where it's all bearded operator games.
Yep. Oh, and this is something else that I learned. The kind of shooter elephant in the room is that these big studios, they now need to compete with free-to-play games like Fortnite or Apex, yeah, Legends. And apparently in the most recent Halo game, the multiplayer was free-to-play to try and sell microtransactions. So that's the general decline and how it kind of represents the decline of the shooter over the course of the 2000s. Let's talk plot a little bit.
Yeah, let's get into the lore.
Yeah. JD,
yeah,
tell me, have you read any Halo novels?
Yes. Yes, I have.
If you had to ballpark, how many would you say you've read?
Four.
Okay, nice. I Googled. There are apparently 20. 20.
I'm surprised there's that few.
So as our you know, expert witness, tell us a bit about the Halo novels.
This is an editor's note. We asked our guest here for an impossible task, which was to summarize the Halo books in a way that would be interesting for an audience. The same thing happened on the Dan Brown episode, and what we got was a very deep discussion of the Halo lore. And I just don't know if I can keep it in or not, but here's a bit of what it sounded like.
Right. First Strike is supposed to be the story of how the Master Chief got home from Halo. And they go with, again, a whole bunch of other, and I think blow the whole thing up. And there's a scene where one of the other Spartans hangs upside down, shooting her sniper rifle one-handed and like kicking the pilots out of space fighters. Like, it's very Legolas killed 5,000 orcs single-handed kind of. And then there was another one called Ghost of Onyx, which I think was the fourth one to come out, which ended up being kind of sad. Because, like, if you just clone someone's kid, they'd figure it out pretty quick, right? So yeah, you know, they abduct a bunch of children, do a bunch of, you know, like, insert science shit here to turn them into super soldiers. And then I remember thinking First Strike was bad. But I'm going to say this. Here's why Halo Fall of Reach sucks. I do not blame author Eric Nylund, because... Ill Fall Reach was released about a month before.
Sorry. And what Spartan are we familiar with?
We're familiar with the Spartan 2s.
Ah, okay. So.
I remember thinking First Strike was bad when I was like 14. Yeah, there's a scene in Fall of Reach where they give the suit to a regular guy, and it's like he moves, and the suit moves with him, right? With like futuristic neural shit, right? But it's so fast that like he kind of flinches, and the suit amplifies the flinch, and then he continues flinching, and it amplifies flinch, and it just like shakes this dude apart, and shakes this dude to death. This is the thing that I could go on about for an hour. It's just, all I remember is it had super over-the-top action and like Spartan porn. You know, Chief, he meets up with some of the other Spartans from his past. So in the plot of Halo, the armor they wear is called Mjolnir. Some of the Spartan super soldiers you met as young folks in Fall of Reach. Ah, the Master Chief met up with them on the way back home from Halo, and they've got their own special skills. One's a sniper. One's the fastest runner ever.
Nice.
You know, the final scene of the game, Master Chief and Cortana have, spoiler alert, destroyed Halo, which, again, to the uninitiated, we haven't even explained what Halo is. We just barely explained what the Master Chief is.
I don't know if that's necessary.
We're assuming you know what these things are, I guess, at this point. Anyway, end of the first game, they've escaped from exploding Halo on a little space fighter. Actually, debunked, but anyway.
Bork!
Yeah,
we invited him here, to be fair.
Master Chief, you know, the Cortana says, Halo, it's over. It's finished. And the camera kind of comes out of the fighter window, obscuring the top half of the Master Chief's body. And you see him
genetically good children.
We won't get into how that might be problematic. That they thought were right scene, for by the time he takes his helmet off. They discover the Master Chief as like a 6-year-old because he's like beating up all the other kids. This is the thing that I could go on about for an hour. So in the plot of Halo, the armor they wear is called Mjolnir. It's
this
Project
is so
Mjolnir.
Weird because like there's not 20 books on Mario Kart. Imagine a Fortnite 20 book series or something. It makes no sense.
I really want to know how we got the floss dance, okay? And the novelization of Fortnite really got into that.
I imagine that is what the other Halo novels are, is like explorations of every side character. Yeah. I know Sergeant Johnson, the trope, like hard-ass Marine sergeant.
Yeah,
gets a lot of his own expanded universe stuff. I'm pretty sure he is a Spartan 1.
He's the black guy from Predator. But he's in Halo now.
Yeah. Scooter, we're going to need you to cut that. First of all, there's two black guys in Predator.
Shit. Now, last thing about the plot and the lore and the world. Something I noticed when doing the research, Halo loves naming factions and naming things with the. So here are like some dumb faction names in Halo. You got the Precursors. You got your Forerunners. You got the Flood. You got the Covenant. You got the Prometheans. You got the Heretics. You got the Remnant, which is a faction of the Covenant. You got the Guardians. You got the Banished. And then little plot devices also get the thing. So you have the Arbiter, the Didact, the Librarian, the Ark, the Cartographer, and the Composer are all either things or people that move the plot forward in Halo. Really love that definite art. So I tried to write my own dumb Halo intro like a madman.
Yes.
So we're gonna have Scooter put the music underneath, and here's what I wrote. In 2587, humanity encountered its most dire threat yet. The Bequeathers, a breakaway splinter group from the Covenant Executors. Their capital fleet blasted the Terran military colony of New Elysium without warning. Only a handful of survivors managed to escape the cataclysm on the USMC ship, the Epitaph of the Deposed. Now, the only hope for the human race is for Master Chief to find an ancient Forerunner artifact, the Hollow Castle, and activate it with the help of his AI Cortana and a non-aligned Covenant elite, the Unraveler. What do you think? As someone who's read three Halo novels.
Please keep going.
No, that's it. That's all I wrote.
Yo, that is exactly what it is.
Do you want to know how I wrote this? Like a Mad Lib exercise. I opened up one Shakespeare soliloquy and I wrote it like a Mad Lib. Like I changed some adjectives and verbs to nouns or whatever, fucked around with the parts of speech. If you want to read the inspiration for this, this is the Hollow Crown soliloquy from Richard II, I believe. Yeah, and I think, again, we don't need to get into all of the nitty gritty of the plot necessarily, but I think what's so kind of like genius about Halo, we talked about the approach ability. There are a lot of kind of generic sci-fi tropes that they just put into a blender. So it's very familiar in a lot of ways.
It's not terribly original. And it's a real exercise in a sci-fi story that's not terribly original, but it's still entertaining. You kind of know the tropes, but it's plotted out in such a way that you are surprised by a few fun twists and turns, and you get to shoot aliens along the way, a lot of them.
Yeah.
And ultimately alien zombies and robots as well. And when you put it that way, you can barely picture Halo. You're picturing any sci-fi. It's like there's robots and space zombies and aliens with squid mouths, and you shoot them with plasma guns like that.
Yeah, I mean, like if you've seen Aliens, you're familiar with the concept of a space marine. You're also probably familiar with the concept of these kind of almost bug-like hive mind. If you've ever messed around with Warhammer 40K, or if you played StarCraft, right? Like these.
Yeah, StarCraft, which borrowed heavily from 40K. It's just this whole lineage that Halo is just happy to be part of.
So let's move on. I think that's good for the plot and the lore. Do you have stuff to talk about Halo and like general pop culture of the 2000s? Like more than just it being a stand-in for gaming and whatever. Yeah, okay. You see people play Halo in the background of movies, but what kind of interaction do you see between Halo and culture broadly in the decade?
Well, it's about a super soldier, and it came out in fall of 2001. Yeah, and it's about, gosh, thank God we had one-man armies ready when the aliens attacked, huh?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the military-industrial complex is not a money pitch. We don't spend billions of dollars on planes that break. We spend it on technology that, you know, will help us win the war.
and not necessarily just technology, but for some reason, making the ultimate infantryman is what will save you from the aliens with plasma ships. And that's like what a lot of the books are about, right? It's justifying, well, how did having the ultimate infantryman win a space war? Like on its face, it raises your eyebrow. And that's great. That's the work. That's the job of fiction, right? You'd want it to be a character that's able to save humanity, right? But humanity saves itself with the ultimate infantryman by the deep state abducting them and
combining with
military technology so that its operators save the galaxy, right? I mean, the first thing the Spartans get used for is like a black op to kill like some sort of like pirate rebel leader, right? And they like kill a shitload of civilians in the process.
Yeah, I read that, or I when doing my research on YouTube, I saw that the Spartans were originally made to fight quote-unquote terrorism and freedom fighters. So probably in the world of Halo, Master Chief has definitely killed some union organizers. That's definitely...
For sure. And I imagine this varies from writer to writer. I imagine there's probably some Halo books that are uncritically like, yeah, I gotta kill the insurrectionists or whatever. But like, yeah, that is what the Spartans were made for before the aliens attacked, right? Is to like, yes, kill union organizers in space without losing a man.
Yeah. And it's really hard to say. Like, I think on the one hand, the game is not actively trying to make a political point. It's more passively reflecting the cult of the military and the military industrial complex in the 2000s. I've seen some readings out there where it's like, where they talk about the Covenant, the alien, the main primary antagonist of the series are these hyper-religious fundamentalists who think that the Halos are religious objects that they want to activate to, you know, kill all Earth or whatever. And I think this like kind of allegorical reading of the Covenant as whatever, jihadism, again, I think it's more just passive, because certainly by Halo 2, the plot line is that you got to team up with some of the Covenant to fight the greater threat, of course, the space zombies in the form of the Flood. Like, I don't think it's narrowly written to be a piece of propaganda. I think it's just you can't help but reflect the time that you're in when you're making art.
Okay. Because traditionally, it seemed like people were saying there's two schools of thought, where one, it did reflect the war on terror. You know, you were fighting against elites, which apparently were originally called dervishes. And they fought with a crescent-shaped sword. And then there's other people who just think it's just shoot 'em up type game. And like, if anything, that culture seeped in through accidentally and not intentionally. So yeah, Jordan, what are your thoughts on like Halo and the War on Terror? Do you think they're reflections of each other?
Well, yeah, Halo, as it goes on to more reflect, not even necessarily the War on Terror, but the culture that comes from the War on Terror. I mean, we're all from North America. I mean, we're all originally from Canada, but our culture always just parallels U.S.
No, we're retconning that whole Canada thing. I'm a born and raised New Yorker now.
Sorry, yes. Yeah, I'm from Canada. You guys, New York.
this is the space in which I am walking, as we say here.
But as so Halo is about, you know, again, like the ultimate infantryman and how just having the best, the most power in a man-sized thing is the coolest thing in war. And that, I mean, that kind of mirrors how infantry tactics would go over the next 20 years. Special forces, and I mean, not necessarily just the Green Berets, but special forces as an idea, have become such this more developed part of how militaries are prosecuting wars across the globe, right?
Mm-hmm.
The quest for the ultimate infantryman has advanced quite a bit since Halo came out.
Yeah. The stupid Navy SEALs, man, they're everywhere, right? Like they are such a big part of the culture considering what they are. Like the amount of books you can read about the Navy SEALs. Like I'm talking stupid business books, how to run your business like the SEALs, stupid self-help books, the history of the SEALs, or Navy SEALs getting elected to political office, like stupid Dan Crenshaw, right?
Yeah, they're worshipped. We always knew about these people. Like you brought up Predator, right? So even in whatever 1989 or whatever this Predator came out, I mean, there's already a popular image of the Green Beret, of the special operator, the army guy who's better at killing people than everyone else,
mm-hmm.
and having sick teams of them going through the jungle, right? That was always something that was in the air, right? But as the war on terror progressed, these people have become worshipped, right? They've become this like really held up as the ultimate examples of competence, right? Yeah. Navy SEAL. I mean, you wanna know how SEAL Team 6 runs their organization. You wanna,
I guess, maybe it's a way of feeling like there's some successful part of the war, right? Because you can't say the army is doing really well because we're losing for 20 years straight, but like the SEALs continue to absolutely do their job.
Oh yeah. They got so many of Bin Laden's number sevens. year after year, they're getting Bin Laden's third cousin. They're getting the guy who got the coffee in the compound. They're just putting up numbers of, you know, the least important guys in Al-Qaeda.
It is so funny that Jocko Willink offers like leadership consulting to like business executives and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there's no way that any of that advice is relevant. It's extreme ownership is what it is. Yeah. Extreme accountability.
You just gotta get at it. I get up every day and I get at it. You get at it. He's never seen that.
Yeah, I've been listening to this very, very cheese self-dev business audiobook called Stealing Fire. And it's about different organizations, you know, getting out of the box, like very stupid Silicon Valley bullshit.
Mm-hmm.
It's a lot about psychedelics and, you know, quote unquote mysticism. And then they also shoehorn in the Navy SEALs, like about how they achieve flow states, what they do. And he describes going to their, I'm not even joking, going to the Navy SEALs mind gym. They have a gym for the mind.
Awesome.
And it's like these giant sensory deprivation tanks that cost tens of thousands of dollars. And I'm like, this is just money laundering. Like, what? This is nonsense. And even the people are like, yeah, so we haven't found a way to train for the psychological conditions that we want. We can only stream, you know, put people through excruciating training and identify, you know, the people who have the flow state or whatever. It's like, shut the fuck up. You just want to buy stuff. For your mind gym.
I had an old boss that started reading military books and then became obsessed with thinking of himself like a general. It's like, we're going to make our organization work more like the military. And that's, I think, who Jocko Willink is selling to. But yeah, he like started rerouting teams to be like functional. And it's like, man, we're trying to get people to like tap more on an Instagram ad here. And you're talking about what the Navy SEALs do. It makes no sense.
Yeah.
I think it's one of the byproducts of living in a society where you're at war, but it's not a part of your life at all. Mm-hmm. You like need to incorporate it into your life somehow to like not have cognitive dissonance about the fact that your country is at war and you're doing absolutely nothing that changes your life at all.
Yeah. I mean, how do you make it as unobtrusive as possible? You do it through like drones, right? So you don't even need real pilots anymore. And you do it through private contractors and then highly trained and specialized special forces. So like you make the footprint of managing the empire as well.
They love to steal.
Yeah. It's
like, they love to steal and murder people. But that goes into another aspect of this sort of rise of the operator, is that they're not just selecting for the best shooter, right? Or the strongest guy. They're selecting for people they can trust, keep their mouths shut when they do sicko shit. And not to be super cynical, like army bad, right? But they're looking for people they can trust. They're looking for people that are willing to do whatever it takes. And a lot of time, I mean, I really suspect a lot of time these guys are being used to do the crimes.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't necessarily mean like the war crimes, but like you want some heroin move, that's it's your Green Berets and your Navy SEALs doing it, right?
Yep.
All right. I want to read one note that I had that's something I didn't get to that is the most nerdy thing.
Sure. Yes.
As I was doing my last minute research, I started to develop some theses. I think maybe if I had some time to let those flavors develop, we might have had a rich stew here, but
okay.
I wrote down the words Thermopylae question. I think in Desert Storm, they were still having battles that were, in terms of number of men, comparable like parts of the Battle of the Bulge. And we don't see that anymore because of this special forcification of things. You have these sorts of tiers of force where someone like 1st Infantry Division, their job now is to kind of hold a perimeter while like Green Berets or Rangers or someone get in there and do the bulk of the killing. And like in our modern world, we have these dense cities and buildings and stuff, right? So that is the Thermopylae question. What happens if you don't have room to put 50 times as many guys in a combat area than your enemy? What if you need to take the inside of a building or a compound where physically you could only send 50 guys into this area or something, right? Then you do want the best guys.
Yeah, you want the guys
in Thermopylae,
much like the Spartans, the guys who were bred with eugenics.
I love that Jordan is doing his Dan Carlin voice for this. Where he's like, what if you only had this many soldiers?
You've only got space for 50 men. What do you do?
Excellent.
You've got an alien force that's better in space. You're better on the ground. So what do you do to make that ground battle happen? And I marvel at this. You want to put yourself in their shoes. You have to make a decision. Are we going to take kids from our own society? I mean, it boggles the mind.
Yes. Excellent.
But like, what if we were at war with our enemy, our mortal enemy? And while we were at war with them, we found an even bigger enemy. Would we join forces with our former enemy if it meant the end of the world? I don't know.
I read about a fantastic guy. He's called the Progenitor. Quote.
What if you owned a woman? I mean, she was an AI hologram program, and she did whatever you wanted, and you could decide where she was and when she was on or off. And I started thinking about it, mostly before I went to sleep.
Just a hot chick. She only gets younger and younger, and more opaque and curvier, and she lives in your brain.
Let's say you find a super weapon in space. Humanity is engaging on a centuries-long experiment. Can we handle our space forerunner weaponry? These halos can eliminate all life in the galaxy.
All right, well, I'd say that's about it. Enough of that.
Yeah. Okay. We've gotten pretty far from Halo.
Yeah. let's go back to how did culture reflect Halo? To the flip side now. First thing that I think comes to everybody's mind is the Red versus Blue series.
The third longest running web series in history is Red versus Blue. And honestly, I watched a little bit of the first episode in preparation for this pod. It's not that bad. There's some half decent jokes that landed. For those who aren't aware, Red versus Blue was a web series that was filmed inside of the Halo game. So it had like little meta jokes about, you know, there's no story behind Halo multiplayer. It's just rack up as many kills as you can on this map. And so they'd make little meta jokes about like, what are we doing here? Why are we fighting over this canyon? To what end? And I don't know. I thought it was kind of funny. Did you watch much Red versus Blue, Jordan?
I did. When it came out, when I was in, you know, whatever, 7th or 8th grade, I was way into that shit. I was really jealous that these guys had this idea. Because what they did was, right, they used whatever arcane analog technology you had to use back then to record the screen in a Halo system link, right?
Mm-hmm.
And just cut off, letterboxed out the parts of the screen that had like your ammo and health on them, and just did real-time performances of these Halo multiplayer guys walking around and talking to each other with like voiceover, just like live in the game in real time, right? Like this,
yeah,
as opposed
machinima.
To going and doing some sort of, it was called Machinima. And I think for a while, Machinima was really taking off, and Machinima didn't go anywhere. Machinima being, by definition, like using a video game to make some sort of film, right?
Yeah, and it's fan-generated content, right? This wasn't an official branded Halo product. This was YouTube before YouTube. Red versus Blue.
You had to go to like redversusblue.com and like watch their videos. There was no YouTube at the time. It was like 2003 or whatever.
Of course, since we're approaching the stupid singularity vertical integration of all forms of content, in the later Halo games, the Red versus Blue guys have little cameos and do voice acting. And there are even achievements in some of the later, like Xbox achievements in some of the later games that are references to Red versus Blue. So, you know, they found the way. You either die a hero or live long enough to see yourself integrated into the product.
Yeah, I guess it's not surprising they brought those guys on as voice guys.
Yeah.
Like they really enjoyed... It's a little like the having Hoobastank and David Cross in Halo 2, right? They got popular, they got a bunch of money, and they were like, we can just get anyone. David Cross was in Halo 2?
Dr. Tobias Funke?
Sorry, I just red versus blued myself.
Nice.
What did he do in Halo 2?
He was one of the Marine voices. So like when the Space Marines, the AI Space Marines that surrounded and helped you in these games, they brought in like a few celebrity voices into Halo 2. So there was a Laura Prepon Marine. There was a David Cross Marine. So like, you know, you'd come across these, you know, NPCs, and some of them would be the voices you were familiar with from Halo 1. And then you'd randomly get one that was David Cross. And so you'd have, you know, some Marines be like, oh, covering fire or whatever. And then one of them would be like, well, I'm glad that alien didn't kill me.
Let's see. Our colonies are blown to hell, the Covenant have found Earth, and our last best hope is a guy in green metal underoos with serious friendly fire issues. I'm great!
There may have been a Michelle Rodriguez at some point. Laura Prepon was definitely in it, because how can you ignore Laura Prepon's flat delivery of everything? Yeah, it's Donna from That 70s Show.
Oh, dang. Okay.
Yeah, so let's move into the worst part of the episode, which is, let's just be nostalgic.
Let's just, for a second.
In the words of Tony Soprano,
remember when it's the lowest form of conversation.
It's the year 2003. You've just finished school on a Friday. Your mother has given you permission to bring the TV over to Billy's house. Because Billy has an Xbox and you have an Xbox.
But Billy doesn't own a TV. Friends. His parents have pawned it.
Well, Jordano, you can only put 4 players on one TV to play Halo. But Halo supports up to 16 players. So with the magic of just one Ethernet cable, you can hook up 2 or more Xboxes and play on 2 or more separate TVs, which, by the way, eliminates screen peeking.
And yes. You can get,
by the way, what map supports 16 players?
Blood Gulch, dude. That's huge.
Yeah, that has Blood 2 Gulch.
And oh, I guess 2
teams
way.
Of 8. Okay.
Yes, 2 teams of 8, buddy.
Yeah, so the first section of the nostalgia debate is the best maps. So let's just talk about some of the best maps.
Warning. Warning. You are now entering the Friendship Simulator. Warning. Warning. You are now entering the Friendship Simulator.
This, I think, this incredibly visual bit that we want to do, it really is the ideal fodder for a podcast.
but the maps that we remember best are the ones that make use of everything. There are some great, honestly really good, like, close quarters maps for you guys to blast each other almost GoldenEye style, right? But the maps we remember best are Blood Gulch, which was this enormous open map that used all the vehicles.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All the weapons and all the vehicles.
For me, because I'm not putting enough effort into a game to remember what the map looks like, and you didn't have to do that with Blood Gulch. It was a big oval, so don't worry about, like, remembering exactly how Hang'em High or Ascension or whatever was built.
It was a box canyon in the middle of nowhere, according to Red vs. Blue, if I recall correctly.
Yep.
I think the pilot of Red vs. Blue is they're standing on top of one of the Blood Gulch bases and being like, why do we need to be in this dumb canyon?
Yeah. This box canyon in the middle of nowhere with 2 bases on either end. It's great.
You could be on the roof of the base, right? And it had a little portal, correct? To take you sort of halfway up the canyon.
Yes.
Yeah.
Remember the portal? Remember when?
Remember portal?
Yeah, like seeing people come over the hill for the first time in like a multiplayer match and being able to snipe them is a very memorable part of Blood Gulch. Next up, I have Battle / Beaver Creek, which I think is like the one that I remember the second most fondly.
Yeah, well, and, also 2 bases in a canyon, but now they're closer together.
Closer together, there's no vehicles, but it is just big enough to you know, have a nice 4v4.
Again, another one I don't have to remember like what the map looks like. Like, I went online and was trying to find out what people's favorite map is. They mentioned Lockout, and I was like, that was too much effort. I'm not remembering how to get around on that one.
There's a map that was in Halo Reach. It was called Ascension, but it might have been called something else. It was one that they remade in a few of the games, but you were on like a giant tower in the sky, and there was a weird Illuminati looking thing, right? Like a pyramid right in the middle of the map. And it was like playing on the Crazy Stairs by MC Escher. There were all these walkways and whatnot, and there was one little tower that you could go on.
Yeah, you were on like a collection of floating rocks.
Halo Reach added jetpacks. I mean,
yes. Not very controversial that they added those sort of armor abilities, but in my opinion, they were really well thought out, and like just they were nice. It was nice. I wish that game became more of a competitive gaming hit, but it didn't, and that's life.
Yeah, not enough games have jetpacks. That's really the takeaway for me.
Another one that I remember.
They posed such a map design challenge. No, Jordan, I'm going to talk for about 25 minutes on map design. Now, the thing about jetpacks is... I'm sorry, go on.
Oh, thank God. Oh, one of the things I love about the stupid Halo lore is the cities that are named New Something. This is like common in a lot of sci-fi games. Like I recently played through XCOM 2, and every single location on Earth is new. It's like New Siberia, New Western Europe, New whatever. And first off, I feel like we are rapidly hurtling into the future, and people are not founding enough new somethings or another.
No.
But even funnier is in some of the Halo lore, again, from YouTube that I watched to prep for this, just horrible place. There's a new Arizona? No, one Arizona is enough. We don't need a new Arizona. Let's like leave Arizona in the past as we move into the far future. New Mombasa sounds cool. That's tight. Let's keep that.
But it does roll off the tongue.
Actually, I want to ask you guys a question. If we were just playing the 2v2, you know, we weren't able to borrow the TV to get the full land going.
Okay.
If you're just doing a 2v2 split screen, what's your favorite type of Halo game to play? Like match type.
Probably Slayer. For 2v2.
I'm sorry,
2v2?
Yeah.
Slayer, yeah.
See, I don't know. I like a solid two-person captured flag.
Really? Well, one person has to be carrying the flag. It's very difficult.
Not in Combat Evolved. In Combat Evolved, wait. No, I'm wrong. You have to carry the flag. You can still drive with the flag in Combat Evolved.
Really?
Oh, nice.
Which does make capture flag frustrating sometimes because the flag carrier can just grab the flag and hop in a ghost. Man, I used to do all that shit. So I used to play Halo on my parents' Macintosh EMAC with like 200 ping at all times. But since I had whatever teenager juice just makes you good at whatever dumb thing you're into, I was just like absolutely constantly owning people with like 200 ping, having to lead every shot, but still getting those like shotgun one hits. And I was just, in retrospect, it's not impressive because I was just playing against a bunch of people that like weren't competitive about Halo, right? So I hop into these 16 people servers and just walk the flag, right? Like get in there, shotgun everybody in the base and like abuse the mechanics of like you do more melee damage if you're running with the flag and shit.
All right, favorite Halo guns stick in your mind.
The way the physics worked around the rocket launcher were just amazing. The way it would send bodies careening or flip the warthog over and over.
Yeah.
That was one of those things we didn't experience before Halo, right? Like it did rocket launcher things as far as do splash damage and like massive damage. But yeah, it also sent the warthog spinning. It sent weapons. Weapons would fly around.
Yeah. Yeah, on the map.
Bodies, vehicles. Yeah. Good call, Giordano.
I love the Needler because it has the funniest, dumbest sci-fi name. What's this thing do? It needles!
And it also makes people explode.
Yep. And in later games, the need I can't remember if the first one did it, but the needles home for some reason, which was a fun thing.
They home less in latter games. In Halo 1, they're real slow, but they have really strong homing.
Yes.
And what they would also do is they'd explode any grenades nearby, which they toned down for later games. But in Halo 1, if someone like died and dropped a bunch of grenades and explosion went off near them, like it would detonate all the grenades and create these massive explosions that could send vehicles like across the map. And they really toned that shit down for later games, but that was awesome.
The fact that the plasma grenades would stick to people was always very funny too.
Yeah,
how has that not come up yet? that's an iconic thing from Halo. That like
yes,
like every game, not literally every game, but like every game since Halo has some sort of sticky grenade.
Yep. Yeah, I remember playing a lot with my boy Kyle growing up. We would straight up play 1v1 Halo, and we lived together at one point, and our roommate thought it was the lamest thing of all time. Just 1v1 people on a map that's designed for 16. You spend a lot of time looking for each other, but there's something incredibly satisfying about sticking someone with a grenade. The game makes a sound effect to indicate that it's stuck. Scooter, put that in post. And we would just say to one another, see you later, Kyle or Ben or whoever. Yeah. And it was the most gratifying flex that you could do. Calling your shot ahead of time. You were about to blow up with a sticky grenade. Good times.
And that's something Halo generated, I think, in players that made it such a killer app, is that like most kills were some sort of style kill. Mm-hmm. If you killed someone with the shotgun, it was because you maybe snuck up on them or used just some real speed and violence. I think that's a Jocko Willink concept, to just get that one, getting closer than they wanted you to, and get that one shot. Bam! Yeah. Or you stick the plasma grenade. Bam! Or you get that sniper headshot that gives them no time to take cover. Bam! Or you kill them in three shots with a pistol. Bam! Like,
yeah. Or you take the assault rifle, like the most basic vanilla gun. You spray and pray as you close in on them. And we haven't even talked about the mechanic of like shields versus health, but you eat up the shield and then you get there and you get the beat down with the melee kill. And it's incredibly gratifying.
Guys, when we did the What's Good About Halo, I got a whole list here and I was doing like the teenager holding his breath meme. I don't want to backtrack us, but that shield mechanic was really ahead of its time, and every game since for like 10 years would use that mechanic.
Right.
Call of Duty 3 came out a couple years later and made that mechanic the whole health system for like every game going forward. The shield,
it's not about how much health you have. It's how much health you lose in a short period of time.
Yeah. Don't need to go like looking around for health packs either. So like you can get nice little streaks going, which again, the narrator rewarded you for. The guy with the dumb voice would say like,
kill atrocity. Kill frenzy.
Again, this is part of like the bro culture that it was associated with. You'd have words like Kilimanjaro or Killpacular to describe like legendary streaks of kills.
And that's one thing Halo did, because games did that before. I think Unreal Tournament was the original testosterone announcer game, right?
Yes.
I think Unreal famously had the guy say, "Holy shit." But what Halo did was Halo bridged sort of two types of shooter too, because you used to have like the army shooter, that really low time to kill, realistic army man sort of controls, right? Mm-hmm. You also had games like Unreal, where your guy could jump 20 feet in the air, move super fast, could take, you know, you had to shoot each other for a long time to kill each other, right?
Yeah.
And Halo moved in between that, where your character was at this quasi-realistic super army man that died kind of fast, but not so fast that you couldn't fight back. Mm-hmm. In almost any situation, there's very few situations besides the power weapons, the shotgun, the sniper rifle, the rocket launcher, where if an enemy engaged you, you wouldn't at least have a chance to fight back, right?
Yeah.
You play a COD game, someone sees you first, they're gonna kill you. That's how
it works. Don't even get me started on Counter-Strike. I played Counter-Strike precisely one time and it was traumatizing to me. I couldn't twitch fast enough to survive.
Halo gave you a game where there was some taking cover and there was some sneaking and stuff, but also you blew each other up with space weapons. I had an announcer that would say, "Holy shit." Well, he did in Halo, but you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Riot.
Yes.
and anybody could just start playing, like, and you didn't have to be some FPS nerd who knew about the map to like at least do a little bit.
Yeah, and I think it just really walked that fine line between too casual and too hardcore.
I think Halo is mostly known for being like a party game, like a lot. I mean, it's the game you remember playing at sleepovers and with friends and stuff like that. So I thought we might finish on like, what were some of your most memorable LAN parties that stand out in your mind for when you played Halo?
I remember in high school, this is like so deeply nerdy, but we went to a debating tournament, or sorry, not even debate, Model UN in Battle Creek, Michigan.
Oh, wow, nice.
Birthplace of Kellogg's cereal. And we brought Xboxes to play on the hotel TVs. And I think we like skipped out on a bunch of the boring Model UN stuff to play Halo. And yeah, just like 2v2 on the hotel TV.
For me, it was always like New Year's Eve. If, you know, your parents would bring you somewhere with like a bunch of families celebrating New Year's Eve. And like, I remember at that point, that was usually when you could get 16 people together to play a giant LAN party, because you happen to have enough like families together. And those stand out in my mind as being like the most fun, like, holy shit. I was playing N64 2 years ago, and now I'm fighting with 16 people and Blood Gulch.
Yeah, like unheard of levels of scope.
I mean, I lived for those nights. I didn't have my own Xbox, but I loved Halo, you know, circa maybe, you know, 2002, 2003. And so, but I also am fucking weird. I would like read like Halo shit on the internet, right? Mm-hmm. And so I'd learn all these gameplay secrets, like the how powerful the pistol really is, or that you can press A to make the ghost nose up to do some more advanced sort of terrain traversing maneuvers. And so I would go to these Halo lands and wipe everybody. All my friends actually had Xboxes, just because I was the loser that was actually thinking about Halo on days that we weren't doing this. And so, you know, like our friends would get together, maybe two or three Xboxes, two or three TVs, you know, we'd have a weekend in like grade eight or whatever. And not only was it my chance to play Halo System Linked, it was my chance to play Halo, really. Plus, I'd always convince people to play Free For All, because Free For All is way more exploitable and you can own people even worse, because you can just let people fight each other and swoop in. So I convinced my friends to play Free For All and get like 25 kills by the time people had like five, just by constantly mopping up gunfights.
And that's what they told you to do online?
No, that's what my dopamine receptors told me.
Do they make games like this anymore? You know, like I'm only familiar with the popular shooters like Fortnite and Call of Duty that seem multiplayer focused. And so I'm wondering, like, do they make games that have like a fun campaign, like multiplayer?
Like games that are sold to be both.
Yeah.
Not really. They really don't.
Yeah. I mean, the most recent Battlefield doesn't have any story at all. The previous two Battlefields, both of which I played, very confusingly named Battlefield 1 because it was set in World War 1, even though it was like the 20th fucking Battlefield game. And then Battlefield 5, which followed Battlefield 1, which was set in World War 2. These had little episodic campaigns that were not good, generally. Like, it was really there for the multiplayer. And fun fact, the Battlefield 5 campaign has a campaign where you play as a good Nazi. As a Nazi who, like, you know, he has some problems with his Third Reich, but, you know, honor, duty, these kinds of things are important.
It's called loyalty.
Loyalty.
Honor. Sometimes your loyalty is your honor. You know,
it's called like the last panzer or something of that nature. Like, man, did we really need the good Nazi narrative?
But no, yeah. Their games come out to be one or the other now.
And even then, like, are there that many FPSs that want to be story heavy?
Yeah, I mean, story or just single player heavy. Like the Doom remake. The Doom remake was cool. I wouldn't say it's story heavy.
Okay.
But it is a mostly single player experience.
Yeah.
And by the looks of it, again, Bethesda made a second one. It looks like they did exactly what they did with Halo. Give it a much bigger like world building. The backstory on the Doom guy. Why did we need backstory on the Doom guy? He's the Doom guy.
He likes keys. He likes to find keys. That's his backstory. I mean, closing thoughts after this, whatever, however long we've been talking here. I think this is something that we've, like, Giordano and I have seen in planning out some of these episodes, the general trend of commerce and capitalism ruining things over the course of the past 20 now years.
Yeah.
Where, like, all of the things that we are, like, gushing about in this nostalgia section are no longer part of not only the Halo franchise, but gaming in general. There's so little split-screen cooperative play. There's so little split-screen multiplayer left because people want you to buy multiple copies of the game and multiple consoles, and you play in your home like an atomized little consumer. It's insane to me that gamers, like through the Gamergate or whatever, are generally associated with right-wing politics, because so much of what sucks about gaming now is just because of the profit incentive. I was shocked to learn that there were microtransactions in Halo, because it seems so very far from, you know, the Halo I grew up with. And yeah, we see the same kind of phenomenon with movies in terms of establishing a kind of IP and then milking it for all that it's worth. I mean, we didn't even get into the attempted, you know, spin-off games like Halo Wars or Halo ODST or whatever. But yeah, any closing thoughts from y'all?
No, yeah, that summed it up. And it's a nice through line with what we talked about with How I Met Your Mother, on how something can be good and then just be forced by the market to be run into the ground.
Yeah.
And speaking of Megatherium, originally the game was actually supposed to have megafauna on Halo.
All right, that's all the time we have.
No. Thank you so much for joining us, Jackie Boy. I do not want to hear you talk about dinosaurs. If you tuned in, thanks for listening. And the podcast name is Remember Shuffle.